Coming today, we are here to announce the filing of a federal lawsuit on behalf of Nydia Tisdale. We're going to have three speakers and then open it up for questions. I just want to do introductions of Nydia and the legal team. We have Brandon Waddell from Kaplan Cobb, Nydia Tisdale, our client, Mike Kaplan from Kaplan Cobb, and then I'm Jerry Weber. And we're going to have Brandon Waddell talk about the basic facts of the case and the legal claims. Nydia is going to talk about her reactions and why she thinks it's important. I'll give some closing statements, and then we'll open it up for any questions. So Brandon, take it away.
Nydia Tisdale believes that when public officials make public statements about matters of public importance, all members of the public should have equal access. She engages in the most objective form of reporting. She films public officials making public statements and posts the videos online for free without commentary, criticism, or injecting her opinions. That's what she did on August 24th, 2014. In the suit we filed last night, we allege the following. On that day, Nydia sat in the front row of a campaign rally, one to which the public had been invited, set up her camera, and started filming. Apparently somebody wasn't happy with that because in the middle of the event, we allege, Captain Tony Wooten of the Dawson County Sheriff's Office forcibly removed Nydia, even though she explained to him that she had authorization to be there. Then Captain Wooten and two other officers confiscated her camera, arrested her, and ultimately charged her with trespassing and felony obstruction. She stayed in the jail that night for hours, until 3 a.m. And when she finally got her camera back 6 days later, portions of her footage in which she was screaming for help were missing. We allege 6 counts in the complaint. First, we allege that Captain Wooten violated Ms. Tisdale's rights under the First Amendment as a citizen and as a journalist when he shut down her filming of the public political event. Second, we allege that Captain Wooten and the two officers he called to the scene arrested Ms. Tisdale without probable cause in violation of her Fourth Amendment rights. Third, we allege that the officers also had no lawful basis to seize Ms. Tisdale's camera. Fourth, we allege that the force these officers used in arresting Ms. Tisdale was unwarranted and left her bruised, scraped, and in pain for some time. Fifth, we allege that the charges against Nydia are unfounded and were brought maliciously to silence her. And finally, we allege that these officers seized Ms. Tisdale's work product, the work product of a member of the press, with no cause to believe the video related to the commission of a criminal offense, in violation of the statute Congress enacted to protect the police, to protect the press from police overreach. Nydia Tisdale is a champion of open government. That irks some politicians who don't want the public to know what they're doing and saying. In this case, officers who were sworn to protect Nydia's First Amendment rights to freedom of speech and freedom of the press, instead, we allege, use excessive force, unjustified arrest, and an unlawful seizure of her camera to silence her. The United States Constitution doesn't allow public officials to bully citizens and members of the press who advocate government transparency. The Constitution protects people's rights to speak, the rights to report, and the rights to be free from violence and vindictiveness at the hands of government officials. Nydia is here to stand for those rights. We're proud to stand with her.
Thank you, Brandon. Ms. Tisdale.
Good morning. My name is Nydia Tisdale. I live in Roswell, Georgia. I am a citizen journalist. I'd like to take this opportunity to give a special thank you to reporter Brian K. Pritchard of FetchYourNews.com, who is sitting behind me at Burt's Pumpkin Farm, and he, Brian Pritchard, broke the story, which I call Pumpkingate. Pumpkingate is the hashtag that I use when I tweet this story. And he also took the iconic photograph of me being forcibly removed from the rally that day in August 2014. I'd also like to thank Jim Galloway for teaching me the new word frog march in his article in the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. I'd also like to thank Bill Simon with Political Vine for teaching me the word frauderism. And finally, I'd like to thank Timothy Pratt with the Columbia Journalism Review for his glowing profile of my citizen journalism work, which appeared this past month online in their publication at the Columbia School of Journalism in New York City. I'd also like to give thanks to three people at Burt's Forum who spoke out against this attack. Linda Clary Umberger, who is the chair of the Dawson County Republican Party. Also, Mark Butler, who is the Labor Commissioner. And finally, and especially, Attorney General Sam Owens, who spoke out against this at the time. And he also defended me when my rights were violated in the city of Cumming. I would like to thank my attorneys, Michael Kaplan, Jerry Weber, and Brandon Waddell, for representing me on contingency in this case, which is greatly appreciated. I'd also like to thank Bruce Harvey, who is representing me in my criminal case, pro bono. I never expected my citizen journalism to lead to my introduction to the criminal justice system in Georgia. I never expected to be attacked in a pumpkin farm when it wasn't even Halloween. Citizens must stand up for their rights. My case is so much bigger than me. It afflicts every member of the press in our country. It's an affront to our freedoms, our First Amendment freedoms, and there's a reason that they're first, that our founding fathers put them first, because the freedom of press is so precious to us to be able to know what our government is doing. And my mission, my motivation for my video journalism is to engage citizens with their local government and to encourage participation and to encourage voters to turn out to the ballots to cast their vote and to exercise their right to vote, because so many countries don't have that. In other countries, reporters are beheaded, they're burned, and we have this precious right that we must protect for everyone in this country. And thank you again for being here this morning.
I have represented Nydia Tisdale in several lawsuits at this point, and I've been very proud to represent her. She has opened the shades of government. She's really brightened the lights, and she's really given an eye into so many places, from city councils to the Georgia General Assembly, courts across the state, all the way to the Georgia Supreme Court. She has filmed political events. She's filmed debates. She has filmed Republicans. She has filmed Democrats, and unlike a lot of media outlets, she shows you the whole thing. There's no bias involved. And she was recently dubbed by the Columbia Journalism Review, a very highly respected review, essentially the C-SPAN, this was the title, the C-SPAN of Georgia politics and Georgia reporting. And so why did Dawson County and Deputy Wooten shut her down? Why did they go so far as to arrest her? Why did they brutalize her? Why did they send her to a barn screaming? We know why. We all know why. We will see in this lawsuit in very stark terms why public officials shut her down. Public officials oftentimes love to talk about openness, but they prefer dark rooms. And we know that when public officials are in the shadows, when they are in the dark, that they are doing something that they want to hide. This lawsuit is to shed light. Nydia Tisdale is here to shed light, and we are very proud to represent her today. And so what we're gonna do is we're gonna open it up to any questions folks have, and I'll kind of field the questions to the right person, but have at it.
I'd also like to thank Forsyth County Commissioner Jim Bach for coining the term Nydia for Nydia's video. He was the first person that used that word, asking a friend, have you seen the Nydia yet?
Thank you. I've got a question. What's your reaction now that you see your video? Because you were the subject matter of that video, but what's your reaction? How do you feel when you see that video and what happens to you?
It's extremely traumatic when I watch the video, and it often brings me to tears. I I have watched it very few times because of that reaction that I get, physical and emotional and psychological. It's just very, quite terrifying to me that that happened with our governor, Governor Nathan Deal, sitting right there with his wife, Lady Sandra Deal, right next to her, to him, watching me being frog marched out of this rally. It's just beyond belief. There's no rational, logical, legal explanation for why what happened happened. And so whenever I speak about this or dwell about this, it does trigger the trauma again. And I often am brought to tears. So it's very difficult to watch. If and when I have to, I'll usually turn the sound down because I can't stand the sound of my screams.
What is your name? Sir, what is your name? What is your name, sir? Identify yourself. What is your name? What is your name? Let go of me. What is your name, sir? Let go of me. I spoke with the owner prior to this event beginning. No, Mrs. Burt, Kathy Burt, said it was okay. Mr. Let go of me, sir. Mrs.
Stop.
Let go. Let me get my purse.
You're going to jail.
Let me get my purse. I need to show you my ID anyway. Sir,
yep.
I need to show you. You need to identify yourself. Mrs. Burtz, I spoke with her in advance.
Ma'am.
I told her I was
no, ma'am.
Here. I was. I have my camera.
Just had the owner of
film.
The place, Johnny Burt.
Let go, sir. Ow! That hurts. You're hurting me.
Stop.
You're hurting me.
Stop.
You are really hurting me.
Stop.
You are hurting me.
All you gotta do is be still.
My screams for help were actually not on my own personal video. They were captured on Brian K. Pritchard's audio recording of the rally. He was able to record the entire rally, unfettered access, and he was right behind me. So there's just no rhyme or reason for why I was attacked, why I was singled out, why I was picked out and picked on and bullied and discriminated against and bullied. I don't understand it, because 3 weeks earlier, in August of 2014, I filmed a very similar rally in the city of Roswell with the same politicians giving the same stump speeches, and I posted that video online with Governor Nathan Deal and with Senate candidate David Perdue, and it was a beautiful video. I really thoroughly enjoyed hearing the candidates speak about their families, about their experience, about their platforms, and I wanted to let voters know that, hey, there's an election. Most people aren't used to voting on May 24th. They think of voting in November. And so you really have to remind voters about primaries and about runoffs because there's such a low voter turnout. So yes, it's very traumatic for me still today.
What are you hoping to achieve with this lawsuit? What's the end game?
I'm hoping for my day in court so I can tell my story and my side, because I have been slandered in the press by others who have made misstatements about me. And it's very hurtful and very painful. And so I want to have my voice heard through my counsel and through this lawsuit. And I will be vindicated. And sometimes the courtroom is the only way to settle a dispute or to settle a disagreement. In our civilized society, the courtroom is the only place that this can be resolved, because my rights were violated and we need to stand up for that. We need to defend ourselves and defend our rights.
I know you're suing the individuals in their individual capacity. Why not go after their employer who might have
deeper
pockets or the ability, not that you're looking for money, but the ability to handle this in court maybe differently?
Sure.
Say your name for us, by the way.
I'm Mike Kaplan with Kaplan Cobb, and I want to add to something that Nydia said, and that is that this lawsuit is going to be an additional avenue for transparency and truth. And one of the things that we are going to investigate as a part of this lawsuit is why, despite Nydia's video being on, or camera being on during the entire episode of Officer Wooten dragging her and frog marching her into the barn. When that video was returned to her a week later, key portions of the video were missing. And one of the objectives of our lawsuit, one of the goals of our lawsuit, is to bring truth to why portions of the video are now missing. We have brought the lawsuit against Captain Wooten, Corporal Bishop, and Corporal Smith because those were the officers involved in wrongfully arresting Nydia and violating her First Amendment rights and using excessive force. This is a civil rights case to vindicate those rights, and those would be individual officers who were involved in depriving her of her civil rights under the United States Constitution.
So they can be held personally liable, even though they were there in their official capacities?
They can be held personally liable, and it will be up to Dawson County as to whether to indemnify them.
Where's the criminal case currently standing? Can you talk about that a little bit?
There is a calendar call in June, and there's a motions hearing scheduled for July 5th, Tuesday, after the long holiday weekend. And the calendar call is to set the schedule for the week of August the 8th. And thank you.
For a trial?
That's my understanding.
Mr. Harvey is Gideon's criminal defense counsel. He was not able to make it. So this is a
One thing we'd like to emphasize is that we sent a demand letter to the defendants in this case a long time ago, and we had radio silence. But shortly after we sent that demand letter, the criminal charges suddenly reared their head again, and criminal charges were pursued against Nydia. One of the things we are going to explore in this lawsuit is why did Dawson County let these criminal charges sit as if they were not going to pursue them, and then change their mind after we sent a threat of civil litigation. They should not be motivated by the threat of civil litigation to bring criminal charges against any citizen.
May I ask a question? What are the chances of a settlement being reached on the civil suit, whereby the defendants would not have the daylight shine on what, you know, the complete daylight shine on what they've done, and allowing the public to see more.
Well, under Georgia law, any settlement involving a governmental entity is a public settlement, and we certainly support that law.
Question. Yes, sir. In your lawsuit, how many constitutional rights, which constitutional amendments are you claiming that have been violated, which violates specifically the freedom of the press? And secondly, if that's the case, I see that you have on here damages not less than $1,000, of course we hope, but how much do you think you could get? $500,000, $1 million, $10 million, $20 million? And honestly, answer this, I'm curious.
Sure.
Might as well throw the money out on the table, let's see what's really going to go on. And I assume this is once you win the criminal case, correct? Then you pave the way for the civil, is that correct?
Well, your first question,
yes.
This is primarily focused on the First Amendment, the Fourth Amendment, First Amendment freedom of speech and press, Fourth Amendment the right to be free of unreasonable seizures and unlawful arrests, and then the 14th Amendment that brings those in and brings them and applies them to the states.
Okay.
So we also have a federal statutory claim because Congress thought it wise several years ago, because so many reporters had these kinds of things happen to them, to pass a federal statute that allowed for damages if a reporter's video or notes were seized by police officials in an attempt to silence them. So we also have that statute, and that's the statute that actually has the language $1,000 or more. So we're just actually tracking the language of the statute.
All right.
What the jury will award, we do not know. We are not the jury. The jury sits in their homes, in their work offices today. And someday, maybe about 2 years down the line, some of the folks that are in this jurisdiction are going to be sitting in that courtroom, and they're going to decide how much the damages are.
So it's the jury's comprised of the citizens of, is it Dawson County or?
It includes Dawson County. It's several different counties within what's called the Gainesville Division of the Federal District Court. So there's several counties involved.
All right. One more question.
Okay.
As an attorney, precedent before, what damages have you seen awarded? Is there a guideline that you're maybe going by? I'm not saying you're going to ask it here, but I've been involved in lawsuits before, so sure. They usually found the guideline where it was proven before and could ask that much. Is there any idea what that might be?
It's really hard to use, you know, other cases as a measuring stick.
Okay.
Because other cases did not involve a reporter's videotape potentially being manipulated.
Interesting.
Other cases did not involve a reporter being dragged into a barn by an officer who throws her on a table on video and holds her there for an extended period of time. Okay. This is a unique case. This is an extremely troubling case. And look at another case that involves the same general issues and say, well, the damages there would translate to the damages here. It's really hard to do.
So it's unique, so it's unlimited. That's a slant, correct?
It's whatever the jury
will unlimited, though, so there's nothing holding it back. Is that correct?
That's true.
Thank you.
Nydia, what's the message you want this lawsuit to send to public officials, to law enforcement, about the journalist's right to cover something like this?
The silver lining for me, Mike, in all of this litigation is that it's a teachable moment. It's a learning opportunity. As the daughter of a university physics professor, if there's a lesson that can be learned from this for citizens and for government officials alike, then there's something good to be found in this case.
And the lesson being what?
That we have inalienable rights that are guaranteed in our United States Constitution. We have the right of free speech, we have the right of free press, and we should not be attacked for exercising our rights. And it's not just me, it's happening elsewhere in our country, and we need to stand up for that. This isn't North Korea, this isn't China, this isn't Russia. I woke up in the United States of America.
Any other questions?
Great, thank you so much for being here. Make sure you get copies of the complaint. If you want us to email you copies, we're certainly happy to do that. We will try to keep you informed as dates arise. This is on a slow track, as all federal civil rights cases are, so there's not going to be any trial, any hearing in the next few days. Thank you all.